Colores is my mathematical father. You know? Okay, he's from the University of Antillas de la Guyana, and he will talk about the differential test for optimal dream.
What did you do? You were showing all of your stuff.
Sorry.
It was a surprise for everything. So good morning, everybody, and it's a very great pleasure to be here for, I don't know, maybe not ninth time, but the first time I came, it was in 2004, and I was organizing a school, SIMPA school, and all the cooperation here is due to Jean-Pierre Couzex, who was the first mathematician from France cooperating with Lima. And now we are at least three having a student from Peru, doctorate student, in a co-tutela with a Peruvian teacher. And all three, we are coming from Clermont-Ferrand. And thanks to Jean-Pierre Couzex. So it is, of course, the connection, Clermont-Ferrand connection. So my talk today will be on sub-differential test for optimality and beyond. I don't remember how long is my talk.
20
minutes. 20 minutes. Okay. And now, this is this, and this. No, this is not the good one. How can I cover this? Maybe a little bit. Ah, yes, here. Okay. So the starting point of this talk was a paper I discovered very by chance in this famous publication, the American Mathematical Monthly. And this is this result by someone I don't know, I didn't know the name before. And the title of the paper, a very short paper, was a first derivative test for functions of several variables. The idea is to give a sufficient condition of the first order, and this is not so common. Usually, sufficient condition for optimality is of second order. This is a condition of the first order. So you have a function defined on a finite dimensional space, continuous on the neighborhood of a point, and differentiable everywhere except eventually at the point x bar. Then f has a local minimum at x bar if you have this condition here, that is in the direction x minus x bar, the gradient is strictly positive for all x in the neighborhood. And you can see that I will draw a picture, maybe even if I have only 20 minutes, but of course. Here you can see here this point x bar, and maybe like this you go like this and you take any point here x, you draw here's the normal of here, this is the gradient of f and x here is here, and the direction x Here, what is the direction x minus x bar? X bar is here. And you can see here. And the angle here is acute. No, it is not in the other direction, no. No, it is exactly like this. And here the same. Can you do the same? And you can see, of course, it is a gradient of this point. And you can see that the direction here, the angle is acute. It means that you have this condition. And if you have this condition, this point should be a minimum. This is the idea of this result. So there are natural questions to ask. For instance, this sufficient condition is not necessary condition, because you can have such a function like this. And of course, here, if you put here the gradient, here, this point x bar, then here the angle is not acute. So it is you have situation where this point is the minimum, but this condition is not satisfied. And there are also other questions if the function is not differential, is not continuous, for instance, at this point or at any point. You cannot use this result. So my idea was to see if it is possible to extend this result to a non-continuous function using subdifferential, and to have a necessary and sufficient condition. Three challenges. So the objective of this talk is to extend this result to a first order necessary and sufficient condition for optimality of non-smooth lower semiconductor function in Banach spaces, not in the finite dimensional space, and using subdifferential. So the plan is to establish a test for optimality using subderivative first instead of derivative. Provide a link between subderivative and subdifferential, and from these two results derive a test for optimality using subdifferential. This is the objective of the talk. And we go beyond, of course. We are mathematicians. We have to ask if it is possible to go in different direction. And here I will show that any kind of subdifferential has monotone. Strong monotone property, like maximum monotonicity. We will characterize the solution set of Minkowski-Varchner inequalities, and finally, if I have time, I will show that for certain function called a bounded function, like a convex function, you have even a stronger maximum monotonicity property for the subdifferential. Everywhere x will be a Banach space, and all the functions will be extended real valued and lower semi-continuous, and of course proper. So the test for optimality using subderivative, the derivative we use is the lower Dini subderivative, defined like this. Of course, it is well known, also called the radial subderivative. And for this, we have a very simply mean value inequality. But here it is a mean value inequality with a sharp condition. It is necessary to have this to get a result. So for any function lower semi-continuous, and if you take a point x bar, we don't know if f is finite at x bar, and x a point in the domain of f. So for any every real number lambda less or equal to this difference, I recall that f of x bar may be plus infinity here, there is some point in the segment between x and x bar such that this difference is less or equal to this directional derivative in the direction x bar minus x, the same like the same order than here, f of x bar minus f of x, and the point x dot here is like also satisfies also this inequality, which will be important. You can see in the convex situation, this is and if lambda is equal to this, this is only this will be the inequality of convexity in the case of f is convex, but here f is not convex necessarily. And from this, it is not very, very easy, very simple to prove this. We need only the fact that the lower semi-continuous function attains its minimum value on a compact segment. This is only the only thing we need. We don't need nothing. And from this, so the fact that we are in a topological vector space plays no role. We are working on the segment. And from this, we immediately obtain this characterization of a minimum point in a convex set for any lower semi-continuous map. X bar is a minimum point of F on this set C, if and only if F of X bar is less or equal to F of Y, for only, we have to test that only for those Ys which satisfy this condition here. This is the case in this here, in this. I use different. It was the inverse of what was used in the previous method here. X bar minus y instead of y minus x bar. So here, for instance, this is the case. This y satisfies this condition here, and you have only to check that at this point is above the value here. Only for those points. The other points don't have to check anything. Because at this point, this condition means that in Y, the function is decreasing. It's starting to decrease. It is a direction of descent. So we have to check that this point is above X bar, because it is decreasing at this point. This is the idea for the next, also for the following reasons. So here. Now, the objective is to have the same kind of result for subdifferential, not for subderivative. So we have to find a link between subderivatives and subdifferential of any kind of function. And the link was known in the case of a convex function. In the case of convex function, the subderivative is simpler because the limit always exists in the case of convex function. Otherwise, we have to take limit inf. And I recall the definition of epsilon subdifferential, but you know everybody knows, and exact subdifferential. And in 66, Rockefeller established the following result. The directional derivative can be recovered through this expression using the epsilon subdifferential of f at point x bar. This is okay. It is the support function of the epsilon subdifferential here. And very long time after, Taylor, I don't know who is Taylor and Borwein, establish a kind similar formula using the exact subdifferential. This formula does not work for exact subdifferential because the subdifferential of f at some point can be empty. So you cannot use this this formula with exact subdifferential because it can be empty. But thanks to approximation of in case of Banach space, not in a general locally convex space. In the case of Banach space, every thanks to a Bronsted-Rockefeller approximation result, you can approximate any at any point. There is close to any point. There is a point where the function is subdifferentiable. So you can use this fact to have this formula here with this set replacing this one, and this set, the definition is almost the same, that is the point x star epsilon is also in the approximate subdefinition of f at x star, but it is also in the exact subdefinition of a point which is close to x star, to x bar. So it is, of course, this set is more precise than this one, and this is due to the fact that you can approximate. And now you have this formula, so using, and you know that this point is in the in exact subdifferential of f, but at a point which is close to x star, to x bar. The proof was a bit complicated. Proof given by Taylor was complicated, and there are some flaws in the proof. This is the reason why Bowen corrected the flaws in the proof of Taylor. What will happen in the case of a non-convex function? The problem is, in the case of non-convex function is that you have plenty of subdifferential. So what? And I don't like to use a specific one. So I will give you, but everybody knows, some ideas of example of subdifferential. The simplest subdifferential are based of the different concept of differentiability here. I recall some of the concept here, and okay, and associated to this concept of differentiability, you have concept of subdifferential, the proximal subdifferential, the Fréchet subdifferential, Adamard subdifferential, Gâteau subdifferential, etc. And you have this inclusion here. Just you take in the definition of the differentiability, you take only one part, limit inf instead of the full limit, and you don't need equality, only inequality is sufficient. And there is another one, which is maybe the first one in this theory of subdifferential, the Clark subdifferential. Here's the definition, much more complicated, and you can check that you have this inclusion. I will not pass some time here, because I will use abstract subdifferential. What is an abstract subdifferential? In what follows, I will need only an object which I call subdifferential, which is any operator that associates a set-valued map connected with f to each function f, so that this object lies between the convex usual with a usual definition of subdifferential of convex analysis. F may be not convex, but you use the same definition. So, in the case where f is not convex, it is very often empty, this set. And in the Clark subdifferential, which is known as the biggest one of this class of subdifferential. And we create also this elementary sum property here, which is satisfied, of course. And this is for the basic what we need. And we also require that subdifferential satisfy a basic calculus rule, which I call separation principle here. Here's this rule. For any function f and phi, with phi convex and Lipschitz, very, very regular function near point x bar, if f plus phi admits a local minimum at point x bar, then we know that zero belongs to the subdifferential of the sum, but we need to separate this, and we need that zero belongs to the sum of the subdifferential. I don't have time to explain what it means and why I call this separation principle. In the case of convexity, this is exactly completely equivalent to the separation of convex set to Hahn-Banach separation theorem. And this is the reason why I call it separation principle. Well, I have no time. So all the previous examples of subdifferential I gave satisfy this condition, if you take some closure of the subdifferential. The Clark subdifferential in any abstract space, arbitrary Banach space satisfies this. The Fréchet subdifferential, if you take the closure of the limits, it is called limiting. A Fréchet subdifferential satisfies this in Aspoon spaces, and Adamard in separable spaces, and Proxima in Hilbert spaces. So this kind of property is not valid in arbitrary Banach spaces. It depends on the type of subdifferential you take. The smaller it is, you have to take more specific Banach spaces. Anyway, I come back now to my objective. It was to establish a link between subderivative and subdifferential in the general case. So I recall that we take this as a definition of subderivative. Again, I will put here a limit inf because the function is not convex. And given a subdifferential, I consider this approximate subdifferential. It will play the role of approximate subdifferential of convex analysis, even if the construction is different, is more, it is closer to the definition of the object S of epsilon used in the formula by Taylor and Borway. This object is all the elements in subdifferential of F at a point which is close to this one, and satisfies also this, it is also in this direction, the value is not too big, is close, is less than epsilon also. This is the definition of this object. And now you have exactly the formula I need. The subderivative at x bar in direction d is less or equal to the same formula as before, except I replace the previous object by this one, and that is the same formula. And we recover every formula. In the case of differentiability, you have this well-known formula, of course, and in the case of convexity, we recover Taylor and Borwin formula. From this, it's now very easy to using the previous characterization of using subderivative and using this inequality, linking subderivative and subdifferential, to obtain exactly the same result as before, using now the subdifferential here. So I can capture also this this kind of situation. The function is not continuous, and this situation here. And it is here. It is necessary and sufficient condition. As a corollary, I recover Botsko result, because in the case where you have this for any y in U, you have this inequality. The set of y such that you have this is empty. So this is trivially satisfied because there is no y to check if you have this. So if you have this, automatically you have that f attains its minimum at this point. And it is important, it is interesting to see that in the case of convex function, this is also a necessary condition. You have this equivalent here, because from here, from A, you have B because of this. From B, you have C by definition of the subdifferential. And from C, you have A also by definition of the subdifferential. It is just algebra to pass from C to A. So we have this equivalent here. But if you look at this, you can see that this means that this pair y star is monotonically related. No, not this. The pair 0 x bar is monotonically related to the graph of the subdifferential. This is what means. This is exactly what this inequality means. So you can see that we are just saying that if you know that the pair here is monotonically related to the subdifferential, then it belongs to the subdifferential. This is what it is called maximal monotonicity. So here, finally, we have a new proof of maximal monotonicity, or different proof of maximal monotonicity of subdifferential. This is what it is explained here. So Given a satellite map, you call this the monotone polar of T. You say that T is monotone if you have this inclusion. Monotone absorbing, which is a new definition, provided you have the inverse inclusion, and maximum monotone, provided you have equality. And what we just proved is that for every lower semi-continuous function f on x, this the operator here, any kind of subdifferential, which satisfies, of course, the separation principle, is monotone absorbing, that is, satisfies this. And in the case of a convex function, immediate that the inverse inclusion is satisfied, so you have that you prove that a subdifferential of f satisfies this equality, maximally monotonistic. Hold on, 5 minutes. Thank you. Now, I would like to in Bosco result, he used so-called Minty variational inequality to see that Minty solution of Minty variational inequality is the point of minimum of the function. And we see here, for instance, that the reverse is not true. So I would like to understand what we obtain a solution of Minty variational inequality. This is what is done here. Characterization of the solution set of Minty variational inequality in the case of subdivided. You have exactly this equivalent here. If x bar is solution of this set system of inequality, then it means that x bar, the point x bar is the function is increasing on all rays starting from x bar. This point, for any y in C, this point here is between x bar and y. And y is the maximum of this. It means that the function f is increasing on all segments of the form x bar y. Of course, it is stronger than optimality. And this is exactly what it means. The same for subdifferential. You have exactly the same equivalence here. And this, as we saw before, this means something about the pair belonging to the monotone polar of the subdifferential. So we have a characterization of the monotone polar of subdifferential. For any function R, for any subdifferential, the set of points which are monotonically related to a subdifferential of f is exactly the set of pair such that f minus x star is increasing along all rays starting from x. And this, of course, this set does not depend on the subdifferential used. The last part, I will go faster. What were the tools we used in the case of convex setting? The main tools are Bronsted-Rockefeller's approximation theorem and the Rockefeller subdifferential sum rule. And in the non-convex situation, these two tools are replaced, the first one by Eklund variational principle and the second one by the subdifferential separation principle, which plays a role for this. And combining these two tools, if you use this notation here, I put this, it is simply the domain of the conjugate of the function f here. You can see combining these two tools that if f is a proper lowest semi-continuous function, if phi is a convex locally Lipschitz function, then the domain of the conjugate of the sum is included in the closure of the range of the sum of the subdifferential. It seems to be complicated, but it is not complicated. The proof is very easy. You combine exactly the two results. And the we look at the special case when, where phi is equal to zero and f is an indicator of a non-empty closed convex set f. This exactly shows that the set of functionals here, the set of functionals in X star that attain the supremum on C because of this definition. And here is a set of functionals which are bound. Here it is a set of functionals which are bounded above on C, excuse me, this is, and here is a set of functionals which attain the minimum, the supremum on C. So you can see that the, this set is dense in this one. And this is exactly, it's called, half part of Bishop-Phelps theorem. So it is not completely trivial, this. And now, what is a Proxbounded function? Proxbounded function is a function such that if I call j is a function half of the square of the norm. And Proxbounded function means that this kind of function is bounded from below. And the infimum is called the threshold of this Proxboundedness. And you can see, from the definition of Proc boundedness, we see that a function is Proc bounded if for every lambda greater than the threshold, you have exactly the domain of this conjugate is equal to all the space. And from this in the previous and the previous result, you get that for Proc bounded function, you have this equality here. Unfortunately, I have no time to go. I just want to say what I wanted to. I go to last result here. We can prove that here, my last result here, for any Proxbounded function f, you have this inclusion here. And this inclusion is much stronger than, saying, maximal monotonicity. It is called maximal monotonicity of Bronsted Rocafort type. And it was studied by Simons and others. And here we get a new approach of this kind of Bronsted Rocafort type maximal monotonicity. And it is for any kind of any function, not only convex, you have always this inclusion here. Gracias por su atención. Y feliz cumpleaños para Jean-Pierre.
In an approximate way, using points nearby. I'm just thinking, possibly in this definition of the separation property, you could also use a weaker property, approximate property. And it seems it will...
Of course, exactly the same. You are right. I use this by simplicity, because otherwise you have to take limb soup of... So, not the, usually subdifferential does not satisfy the separation principle. You have to take the limiting on, for instance, you have to take the limiting subdifferential U. For the first time, you were the first to use such kind of limiting using sequence instead of topological nets. And this is. From this time we call this limiting subdifferential, and it is only this object which satisfies the separation, not the subdifferential itself, the limiting of subdifferential. So instead of this, I could have put limiting in the definition of the separation instead of, it is just for simplicity, yes. But you are right. Yeah.
Now I like limiting objects less than I used to. And I think a few things could be simplified if you don't take actually limits and formulate the conditions which you need in an approximate limit.
This is just it is the same. You put you put limiting in front of the subdifferential, it is the same.
Not exactly.
In the case, because the second function is convex locally Lipschitz, so it means that the differential is locally is compact. So you can separate this. Yeah. You are okay.
Okay. Thank you.